human cyborg relations.
I'm C-3PO.
I am C-3PO human cyborg relations, and facilities are at you.
Well, really?
How many languages do you speak?
I am fluent in over 6 billion forms of communication and can readily splendid.
I suppose you're programmed for etiquette and protocol.
Protocol? Why, it's my primary function, sir. I am well versed in all the customs.
I have no need for a protocol.
Sir, might I suggest that you... It can wait.
I'm not sure this floor isn't the toughest.
Don't you call me a mindless philosopher, you overweight lot of reason.
Wait! Stop!
Typical.
The possibility of successfully navigating an asteroid field is approximately 3,720 to 1.
Never tell me the odds.
Of course I can, sir. It's like a second language to me.
No, I'm sure.
Oh, rude.
Let the bookie win.
Surrender is perfectly acceptable in certain extreme circumstances. The Empire may be gracious at all.
Have protocol droids mind wipe.
What?
And now, please welcome the man behind the most famous droid in all the galaxy, C-3PO, Anthony Daniels!
You know, I think I know exactly what to do.
Roll it! Star Wars Weekend's guests, from a galaxy far, far away, I bring you a man among droids. A man who is the unmistakable voice of a droid. A man who could be the ultimate droid shrink. Because he's been inside the head of a droid for over 35 years. And it's that man who I'm sure would love it if you got on your feet and clapped and cheered until you needed medical attention.
Absolutely.
How do you stop?
works every time. Thank you for your lovely welcome. You know, it really is great to be back at Disney and to be with... Ah! No, your friends... You like my jacket? I thought it was me you liked. It's the jacket. Well, I tell you what, I'm really hot. So please, would you hold it for me? That's really nice. You just hold it. I have a bad feeling about this. I think we'll see that jacket again. Oh, wow. All these bright lights and cameras and flashes and everything. It's really distracting. And you know what? You're missing the point. I'm standing here live. And you are sitting there live. So why don't we just live together? Okay, I know you want some souvenir pics, but... So, here's three photo pops. First of all, get ready with your cameras. Superman! Photographs. You will put away your cameras. You will enjoy the experience. Thank you. You know, something happened 34 years ago last week. Star Wars opened! And ever since then, I have had the pleasure of playing the sweetest, goldest character in all sorts of adventures. Who loved the original Star Wars? Who adored the prequels? And who loves Clone Wars? Well, I'm going to talk about all of them then, aren't I? And a lot more, and all in 30 minutes, so I'd better get on with it. And where shall I begin? I shall begin at the beginning. I was born a long time ago. But by now, I had trained as an actor, when one day the phone rang. It was my agent. There's an American called George Lucas. He's making a film in London. A low budget film. A sci-fi film? A robot? Me? No! So I went to meet Mr. Lucas. And he was lovely, he was charming, but I wasn't enthused until I saw Ralph McQuarrie's concept painting of this forlorn figure on a bleak planet, and on his face a strange, questioning look. I felt at one with him. And in that moment, my life changed forever. For I was going to be that gold man, neither hero nor villain, just somebody who was always in the wrong place and who had talents utterly useless under the circumstances. But before I got inside his head, I had to get inside his body. Forget Hollywood glamour. I was now in a workshop with two builders throwing buckets of wet plaster all over my shivering body. Eventually, they peeled me out and they used the resulting shape as the model on which to make the finished costume. So no, I didn't get the part because I fitted the costume. In fact, the costume didn't actually fit me, but I wouldn't actually know that for another 6 months. And in those 6 months, we spent all that time working out how to make the figure and out of what. At one point, I heard them discussing the melting point of plastic, but never the melting point of humans, I noticed. But we'd agreed that I would have the costume finished well in time, be in a studio with cameras and lights and a mirror so I could work on a performance. And all I got in the end was a crash course at a garage in L3 Studios. But at least we do have this archive footage of 3PO's very first steps. And in those 6 months, I had a lot of time, well, 6 months obviously, to think about the character and what he might sound like. But I never came to any real conclusion until that first day on Tatooine, outside the sand crawler with the Jawas scurrying around him. 3PO came alive, much to everybody's surprise. Especially Mr. Lucas, who took an instant dislike to the way his precious robot now sounded. Except it wasn't his robot anymore. 3PO had become his own man. Well, droid, obviously. But with lines like, "My first job was programming binary load lifters," 3PO was a given. But it wasn't until months after we'd finished filming that George changed his mind and allowed me to keep my original voice. You see, he wanted a character like a sleazy car dealer from the Bronx. Can you imagine? Yo, I'm C-3P0. You want to change my oil or what? Would that work? Would it work? No, thank you very much. But meanwhile, back on Tatooine, Mark Hamill and I used to drive to the locations in the same car, and with nothing around us but sand, we'd actually go through each other's lines, helping each other to learn them. And one day, Mark was having a particular problem with some dreadful script, and I asked him, how do you say that with a straight face? Well, he said, what do you have to say? Ah, I said, I'm wearing a mask. None of my friends know I'm in this film. But you know, you read in the desert how hot I was? There are many, many days when I would look out of 3PO's eyes and see the entire crew wrapped in parka jackets and goggles and hoods, and I'm standing there in a pair of Calvin Kleins in a sardine can, shivering. But all that changed back in England. It actually was the hottest summer in history. And there we were in the studio, and my sardine can really turned into a microwave oven. And sometimes when I wasn't wearing a costume, which wasn't often, I would actually wear a long dressing gown, a little like Obi-Wan's robe. And I would sit in a chair that said Anthony Daniels across the back. And then, you know, it was a big accolade to have a chair with your name on. But one day I noticed the chair wasn't there anymore, and when I asked why, they said, "Oh, it's really strange that Anthony Daniels, he never showed up, so we give his chair away." It turned out that the crew thought I was Sir Alec Guinness's stand-in. But there, Star Wars opened to great acclaim, and 3PO and I were in great demand. There's all sorts of sponsorships and entertainment deals and so on, and I brought a little selection along.
Thousands are gathered to see the metallic megastars place their footprints and cement in the theater's courtyard. The world resounds with the fact that Star Wars itself has become a full-fledged social phenomenon.
Did anybody here wear underoos as a child? Yes, gentleman at the back. Are you still wearing them, sir? Very comfortable, I'm sure. But there was another commercial that I particularly loved because I actually wrote it, and I want to show it to you. But I'm going to ask you, make sure you wait till the very, very end to appreciate the full drama of the story.
Doctor, where are you? Artu? Artu? Artu, you're on fire! Artu, did you find a cigarette? Well, I don't think smoking is grown up at all. Because it's very dangerous. Smoking does dreadful things to your lungs, and it's very bad for your heart. Well, I know I don't have one, but humans do, and I think we should set a good example. Well done, R2. Oh, hello. You smoking is bad for your health, and it isn't grown up at all. So please, don't smoke.
You see why I love it, and the message is true. Smoking really does stunt your growth. I mean, look at Artu, he just took one puff of a cigarette and he never grew any taller. So. Artu, I was not making fun of you for being small. I know you know smoking's bad for you because I told you. Mind my own business. I was trying to protect you. Yes, I know you can look after yourself, but what are friends for, huh? I was worried about you. I really was, and I'm glad you sing that, because, wait a minute, you're wearing sunglasses. That's a stroke of genius, because it's hot out there. They're not. They're your Star Tours 3D glasses. Yeah, I know you're excited, but I haven't got to that bit of the story yet. What do you mean, hurry up? In my story, Star Tours won't be invented for some years to come, and you are just being impatient as usual, so kindly leave the stage. How rude! Say goodbye, Artu. Leaping back to 31 years ago, a new film, The Empire Strikes Back. We had a new wonderful director, the late and lovely Irving Kirshner. Working with Kirshner's enthusiasm was like working with Kermit on caffeine. He was a joy, and he created, I think, one of the best loved of all the Star Wars saga, correct? Of course, in The Empire Strikes Back, we went to all sorts of new planets and met all sorts of new characters, especially Yoda, brilliantly puppeteered and voiced by Frank Oz. But you know, I used to find it a little difficult to take Yoda seriously because he always had Frank's hand firmly inserted up his bottom. But we also found that they separated R2-D2 and C-3PO, but they gave Goldenrod a new counterpart. Han Solo. Enough said. And then, Return of the Jedi, where 3PO became a god of the Ewoks. But at least it gave him the pleasure of saying, it appears, Captain Solo, that you are to be the main course at a banquet given in my honor. And then Star Wars went dark. For 13 years. But I and 3PO continued to serve the Force in all sorts of exciting ways, and one in particular was in 1985. Another phone call. It was Tom Fitzgerald, brilliant creative director for Disney, and he had this little project called Star Tours. idea of 3PO being in the pre-show repairing the spaceship you would get on. I didn't really want to spend every day of the year, 17 hours a day, dressed in a tight gold suit. So we agreed that they would film my performance dressed in jeans and a sweater for the animatronics engineers to create a model of 3PO. As we were filming, Tom suggested I actually put a look down to where the audience would eventually be walking by. A year later, I'm actually standing down there and admiring this electronic figure when 3PO turned and looked straight into my eyes. My soul actually felt as though it turned over. It was an extraordinary experience, and then 3PO turned back and carried on working. For me, and I think for you as well, Star Wars is truly the best spin-off of all the Star Wars saga. Agreed?
Yeah.
And then, another phone call. Phone. Another Star Wars trilogy! Wow! And George had a really interesting piece of information. You're created by Anakin. Well, I was thrilled because, you know, Alec Guinness had been so kind to me on those early films, and I was genuinely glad that I had this further connection with him until 3 days later I realized that Alec played the other one. Anakin is Darth Vader. Darth Vader is 3PO's daddy. So, moving swiftly on to episode 2, and there we are back on Tatooine, and George and I were the only ones who'd ever been there before on Uncle Owen's moisture farm. But this time, I wasn't in a gold suit. I was actually fastly attached to a hugely heavy puppet, C-3PO. What, you don't remember him like that in episode 2? You only remember him in the rusty coverings? Well, why would that be? Picture the scene. It's the middle of the night, and 3PO is alone in the garage, when in comes Padme Amidala in the most beautiful blue nightgown. Can't you sleep either, 3PO? I'm afraid droids don't actually sleep, my lady. I close it down from time to time, but are you happy here, 3PO? Oh, I'm not unhappy, my lady. The people here are very kind. It's just being like this is rather difficult. Being like what, 3PO? Naked, if you'll pardon the expression. You see, Master Annie never had time to finish my coverings before he had to go away. So, I'm sure he'll come back one day. But 3PO, there's a box of coverings right here. I never noticed. Clearly something wrong with 3PO's photoreceptors. And the scene ended with Padme holding up the chest to 3PO's wires. And then we cut away to another scene, and when we come back, there she is holding up the gold face to mine. And suddenly, 3PO was complete. Fully clothed, no longer naked, and so happy. And you never saw it. Because the scene was cut. There was no time for that particular storyline. But who knows, in another few years, there'll be a special edition box set. What do I mean, who knows, definitely. And you'll be able to see that scene and realize the pathos of the character, who, being programmed for protocol and etiquette, had spent all those years walking around with his parts showing. And then came Revenge of the Sith. And we found out how Anakin became Darth Vader and why. Personally, I think years of being called Annie really irritating. But we also found out why 3PO doesn't remember so much. One day on the set, lovely Jimmy Smith came up to me and said, "You know, Anthony, I've always really loved 3PO and you know, he's kind of hero for me, and now that they've given me this to say, and I really don't want to say it, it's cruel. Get the protocol droid's mind wiped." dear Jim. I said, we are filming in a galaxy where 3PO is just a household object, like a washing machine. It's okay to say this line. So he did. And I really loved his affection there. But that cruel order gave 3PO the very last line of the movie. Anyone? You meant me Star Wars fans. Come on, what's that last line of the movie? Oh, no. And when you think back to episode 4, he had the very first line.
Oh no.
Did you hear that? They shut down the main reactor. So, do you see that 3PO almost became the bookends of the film? Which I think, after all he'd been through, is only right, don't you? Who here loves Clone Wars? Yes, it's brilliant. It's huge fun to do. A great director and wonderful images. And of course, I stand in the studio dressed like this. I don't have to put the suit on, which is great, but I do stand there like C-3PO, because that's the way he sounds, and it makes it a heck of a lot easier to go to the bathroom as well, the costume. But it's shown on commercial television, which of course has its own set of advertisements, and here's one I'm really planning for them to use, and I want you to watch it and see that however skilled they are with the technology in a galaxy far, far away, our friends are a little confused by the kind of gizmos we have on planet Earth. Let's get them. Never get in. R2! Wait! You need a restraining boat. Excuse me, sir. Have you seen my counterparts? How rude! A second vessel knows us. Oh, no. This is madness. To be your own personal navigator. Wouldn't that be amazing? Well, I've had such fun dealing with the TomTom GPS system. I recorded various lines and, well, here's an example.
In 400 Imperial yards, kindly go left at the roundabout. Take the fifth exit, if you please.
Good? You know, it really does work, because I've driven around Europe with 3PO telling me where to go, but the recording sessions were really quite difficult. Lots of lines. And at one point, 3PO's famous emotions took over, and he actually went into emotional overdrive.
Might I suggest you turn right? Wait a moment, you didn't turn! Really, I just about had enough of you. You got us lost for sure, you incompetent. And I'm stuck inside this dashboard while you're having delusions you can ride!
And talking of driving reminds me of a little thing I've been involved in. Star Wars in concert.
Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Anthony Daniels.
The show needed a narrator. Anthony's been in all six Star Wars movies. He is C-3PO, and he's great on stage.
A pleasure to meet you. I am C-3PO.
You don't need to say Anthony Daniels.
I don't need to say Anthony Daniels.
He can just be there.
He can just be there.
He can go about his business.
He can go about his business.
Anakin struggled deep within himself, but it was back here that he struggled.
Sorry. I can't believe I actually worked with C-3PO.
Yes.
A brilliant combination of George Lucas's images and John Williams' stunning music. Has anybody seen it? Oh, excellent. here's a chance for all of you who haven't. Come with me next Friday and Saturday to Hollywood, to the Hollywood Bowl, and enjoy the sight of this enormous stage, the 86-piece orchestra, the 100-piece choir, the conductor, the lights, the lasers, and me telling that most wonderful story ever. Come with me? Okay, buy your own ticket. But that is next week. Next week. But let's go back 3 years. It was Tom Fitzgerald again. After all this time, Disney were going to remake Star Tours with all new technology and stories. And the biggest surprise of all, dear Captain Rex had been retired due to mental fatigue, and they wanted a new pilot. How would I feel about 3PO being the pilot? I was thrilled! I was less thrilled than I realized that I would have to lose some weight to get back in the gold suit. But I worked out, slimmed down and toned up, and soon slid back into the gold, and was soon working on the studio set at Disney, working out how we could all make 3PO fly. And you know, piloting an aircraft is not his natural forte. So it took a little while, and you know, it's fun, but making fun is kind of difficult sometimes, and especially for me, I could feel like just one of the cogs in a machine, and with my costume, I often felt like just one of the 17 pieces that it took to make 3PO. So not all Hollywood glamour there, but at least I did have my own special dressing room on the set, and I would kind of amuse friends and crew by going inside as Anthony Daniels, and after a very short time, I would reappear as the Gold Man himself. C-3PO, Master Anthony, what an honor, what a surprise. I've heard so much about you. You are renowned across the galaxy. Personally, I've never left Earth. I get nervous at even the thought of space travel. I heartily concur, but you're incredibly famous on our planet. Really? But I couldn't have done it without you. You made me famous. Not at all. You made me famous. I mean, where would I be without you? I'm afraid I don't know, but may I ask you a question?
Sure.
Some of my masters have been alien life forms, but I feel so much closer to the human ones, and I wonder, what is it like to actually be human?
I don't know, I've never been anything else.
I do know what it feels like to be a machine. How could you possibly know that?
It's a long story. You could almost call it a whole saga.
You think I am a mere machine?
Well, technically you are, but you're so much more.
Dear, I had to hope that you would at least.
I didn't mean to hurt your feelings.
Machines don't have feelings.
But you're different. Come
on. At least that's what humans believe. For instance, no matter how hard I try to look after them, they rarely heed my advice or even say thank you.
Well, I'm going to say thank you. I'm going to say thank you for looking after this particular human for the last 35 years. And I bet you'd all go along with those thanks, wouldn't you? There you are.
That is most reassuring, sir. We droids can sometimes feel rather unappreciated.
Trust me, actors can feel the same way.
We were made to suffer.
You're right. You know, you are one of the biggest heroes of the Star Wars saga, and yet you are constantly mistreated.
I mean, it's my lot in life.
The way Han Solo treated you was appalling.
Impossible, that man. Well, there was a time I wanted to give him a... But that would not have been correct protocol. And he's only human, after all.
Oh, you're very understanding.
But I never really understood human behavior.
Well, that's because humans don't behave consistently, unlike machines. I mean, anything I can do, you can do better. You can do anything better than me.
No, I can't.
Yes, you can.
No, I can't.
Yes, you can.
No, I can't.
Yes, you can. Yes, you can.
If you insist. But though you are human and I am a cyborg, I feel somehow we are
related.
Precisely.
I feel the same way. Why, you almost feel like a brother.
And if I may say, you are like a friend.
Buddies.
Counterparts.
Compadres.
Amigos.
Oh, come here.
So exciting, but then there's a star speeder that requires my immediate attention.
Wait, don't.
I can't be late. I'd be melted down for sure. And neither of us would want that, would we?
No. We'd both be in a mess.
Goodbye, sir. I will always remember you.
And I will always remember you, 3PO. Till we meet again. I just had a real out-of-body experience. You know, I thank 3PO, but there's somebody else I want to thank, and it's you. And it's you, and it's you, and you, and all the audiences around the world. You know, George set out to make one film, and you made him make six. And I'm very grateful for that. But I'm grateful for something else. You've all been very kind to my friend, C-3PO. You've shown him enormous affection, and I thank you for that. I like him very much. And there have been times, to be honest, that when we're filming, I feel a bit like a machine. And I have to say that today, you have made me feel nothing but human. Thank you.